My name is Lauren Aleksunes. I am a faculty member in the Ernest Mario School of Pharmacy at Rutgers University. And today we are in the Environmental and Occupational Health Science Institute at Rutgers. So I study the toxicities and side effects of cancer drugs. We focus on one drug in particular, which is cisplatin or platinol. It's a medication used to treat testicular cancer, ovarian cancer, head and neck cancer, and lung cancer. It's a project I started as an undergraduate, and my research project at the time was to understand how cisplatin is toxic to kidney cells, and specifically looking at how gender affects the kidney damage. Once I became a faculty member, it became a major focus of our research. I'm from Connecticut, Berlin, Connecticut. While no one in my family was directly a researcher, I have been influenced by my mom and my uncles, who are science and technology teachers, as well as my aunts, who are nurses. And so the idea of science and healthcare was something that was very common within our family and made it very natural for me to become both a scientist and a clinician. So I've always been interested in science. It goes back to childhood. A number of years ago, my father and sister were actually going through old videos from Christmases when we were children. And in one of the videos, I open up one of my presents from Santa Claus, and it's a microscope. And I turn to the camera, probably 7 or 8 years old, and say to my parents, I can finally start doing my experiments now that I have a microscope. The fact that we do a lot of research in the toxicities of cancer has a lot to do with the fact that my mother passed away of cancer when I was in college. I had finished pharmacy school and was a graduate student when she passed away. And so watching her and working with her while she was undergoing chemotherapy was a very memorable experience. And of course, focusing on the good sides of cancer chemotherapy and trying to shrink the size of tumors is important. But as a pharmacist, and more importantly as a daughter, seeing some of the debilitating side effects was very difficult, kind of on the at the more personal level to see a patient undergoing. And so that's become a very important focus of our lab, is how do we better predict and manage some of the side effects of cancer drugs. So there's a lot of really cool scientists trying to cure cancer. We're trying to just make it more tolerable and safe for patients. And our other aspect is we're also trying to see if we could develop drugs that could help protect against those toxicities. So is it possible to have a second medication you take with your chemotherapy that would lessen the degree of the side effects? In order for a physician to know if they've caused damage to the kidneys, you would in theory have to go in and take a piece of someone's kidneys. Of course, no one's going to like to have a biopsy taken. It's painful and there's lots of risks. So instead, we're looking for biomarkers, essentially proteins in your urine that would reflect or indicate that there's been damage to the tissue. So for our studies, we are collecting urine from patients who have cancer and who are undergoing cisplatin chemotherapy. And so we look at multiple days after they've had their infusion and measure different proteins in their urine. So normally, you should have very little protein in your urine. You think of your kidneys kind of like a colander, and when you're making pasta, you're going to pour your pasta and water into the colander. And so just like your kidneys, water is going to go through, as well as very small materials or very small pastas like orzo going into the urine. But the majority of the noodles will retain in the colander. When there's been damage to the kidney, you're then going to have those holes maybe getting larger or more leaky, and you can have pasta and other larger materials going out. So same thing in your urine. If your kidneys are not working, we will now be able to detect proteins using very sensitive technology that would indicate that there's been damage to your kidneys. And so that's one of our main projects. And we've been able to identify some really interesting proteins that are changed early before you have other more clinical diagnostic measures of damage. So the ultimate goal of the research is that when a patient is diagnosed with cancer, there's going to be their clinician will go in and determine these are the medications that would be the most efficacious and give you the most benefit in killing your tumor. At the same time, what I envision is in parallel that the clinicians will be able to look at the five different cancer drugs that would be important in treating that tumor and be able to then use the patient's genetics or other risk factors to say, this is going to be the one that's not only the best for treatment, but also the safest. By understanding an individual's differences, not only in their tumor, but even in their genetic code, we can better prescribe medications that are not only going to cure their tumor, but also not leave them with any debilitating long-term side effects that's going to necessitate treatments like dialysis or transplantation. My desire to become a researcher really was solidified by an internship that I did at a drug company when I was in pharmacy school. And so understanding how drugs are made and how they're going to be used in patients was really critical, but really from the research aspect. All of my previous training as a pharmacy student was classroom and how we use the medications, but not the science behind a lot of how medications are made and how we determine what is acceptable risks to our patients, especially those with cancer. All of science is challenging because on a day-to-day basis, experiments don't work. You have to kind of retool your ideas, trying to develop, you know, scientific methods that are going to appropriately answer your question is critical. So there's challenges every day, but I don't see any of those as insurmountable. That's just part of doing science. And it's actually the fun part of science is the troubleshooting and the problem solving. Probably the most exciting thing is that every day I look forward to coming to work. There's not a day that I, you know, begrudgingly am going into my job. And so every day is different. Some days I'm in the laboratory, some days I'm lecturing to students, some days I'm presenting our research or I'm writing up our research to share with the scientific community. You spend a lot of time scratching your head and going back to the literature and designing second experiments and third experiments to help you understand what happened and why it was different than what you originally thought it would be. Would I call myself a science nerd? Absolutely. Absolutely. I love watching scientific TV shows. I think most people are familiar with toxicology from watching forensics shows like Bones or CSI or NCIS. That is one aspect of toxicology and a very exciting part. And trying to understand how chemicals in your environment, as well as poisons and pharmaceuticals, can all have negative health outcomes. And there's other disciplines within pharmacy that are more the physics or more the chemistry sides of drugs. But pharmacology and toxicology are the good and the bad aspects from the biological standpoint for medications. The most exciting part is having our project be able to move from the laboratory bench into patients. We have clinicians in our laboratory in addition to our PhD level scientists. So our PhD level scientists understand a lot of the molecular biology, what's happening at the level of the cell, and our clinicians who can provide perspective of taking care of patients and what's going to be important in improving human health. We're very fortunate to have all of the tax dollars that support our work in allowing us to, you know, put forward some really interdisciplinary and high-level questions that are all aimed at getting to our patients and improving their overall health care and quality of life. If every experiment that I had a hypothesis for worked as planned, it would frankly be pretty boring. The cool parts of science are the unexpected. And when you actually have experiments go in the complete opposite direction, that's actually where we're going to accelerate science even faster. So it's really important for the next generation of scientists to be creative, to be flexible, to be able to work with all different types of backgrounds, and experiences. And so that's really the exciting part of science. If every experiment went as planned, it'd be a very boring job. And so it's the diversity and the failures that help you kind of move forward and advance the science. And so the idea is that, you know, in learning through these challenges is that we're really getting to what the true answers are. And that's going to allow us to be able to have more revolutionary breakthroughs in taking care of patients. For other careers, you may go in every day and do the same thing, and it could be not as challenging as you might like in your career. In areas like research, you have different projects from day to day, so you're constantly thinking about new things, learning about new fields of science, even different than those that you studied when you were in school. So if you're the type of person who likes to ask a lot of questions, why does this happen? Why does something else happen? And you don't mind the fact that you're going to have to kind of rethink your ideas, reformulate your ideas to solve problems, and you're looking for something to challenge you every day, then you're the type of person that should be looking at research for a career.